there and welcome. My name is Carlos Berdes, and let's talk about what has been going on in the indie tabletop RPG scene during this last week. And this episode, we also feature an interview with Momatos, the game designer, but most recently, creator of the Across RPGC platform. So, to the news. Let us begin talking about what is still going on with ZineQuest, because there are still some projects live. However, we have Kickstarter just abandoning the projects that are still going on, and they removed it from the front page. However, at least Adam Bell organized a filter search in a way so that we can easily find the many projects still going on. There were around 70 projects when they just dropped it from the front page, and last time I checked, at least something on the 40 projects were still live, and I think that you should check it out. As always, in my episodes of In The News, you have the links in the description. And on the other hand, we have a very positive thing that happened this week. That was John Harper, the creator of Blades in the Dark, but also Laser and Feelings, publishing a new license for Laser and Feelings. And this license now allows people to sell their Laser and Feelings hex. It was announced by him on both Laser and Feelings itch.io page and Twitter. And talking about creations and creators, So Muppet is looking for creators in 2021. They are looking for mainly writers to create adventures for Best Left Buried and Orbital Blues. The idea is to have people that are already experienced with writing RPGs, but there is also no need to have any published material or a particular knowledge about So Muppet products to apply. So they also mentioned that they are extremely looking for an extra interested in applications from marginalized demographics. If you are interested, see the link in the description, as always, with further information and instructions on how to apply. Talking about marginalized voices, we have two sources of resources for marginalized voices to mention here. The first one is not directly related with indie RPG directly, so it's still close enough for me to mention here, and I'm call the shots here. So the first one is I Need Diverse Games and McElroy Family Podcaster 101 Grant, which is aiming to give some BIMPOC voices a kit with a book to start your own podcast and a Blue Yeti microphone. So in order to either start your own podcast or further improve the podcast that you already have. But they are looking for people that are in still the first steps, not someone that is already established in the business. Further information can be found following the respective link in the description, as always. And the second one is the Layout Level Up bundle. It still has some licenses, or they still had when I last talked up with them. It was on Wednesday night, and it is available for marginalized people. I spoke with Speak the Sky, who is taking care of most of it, and at least around 20 licenses were still available. Also, anyone interested in helping this initiative can donate to their Ko-fi page in order to make layout suites available to more marginalized people. You can find the link to apply for the license as well as the Ko-fi in the description. And it's always started with this bundle where they were aiming to the money that was gathered with this bundle buy different licenses for Affinity Publisher and donating these licenses for people in the RPG industry, in the indie RPG industry, for marginalized communities, for them to have a better suit to use in creating their games. In a bit of a change of subject, this weekend on March 13th, we will start the RPG Kitchen Tabletop Boost Games Day. And you can still apply to play, at least when this video is going on. It has more than 40 games and it will have at least 40 hours of content going on. But as we are almost there on the date, you better hurry. Also, we're starting, but this time it is today, on Friday the 12th, we have the launch of RPG Latam Jam on itch.io, organized by some members of the Brazilian and Argentinian scene for people to develop content for RPGs released by RPG Latam creators. So it is a very good opportunity to gather some other people that were not already familiar with the content and connect them with the RPG Latam community. And you know that this is one of my passions. So check out the link in the description and create something in tandem with the RPG Latam scene. The jam will run until April 11th, and it is kind of a big deal. Having a great article written by Chase Carter for Dicebreaker, so you really should check it out. Also, if you know any RPG Latam creator that is not from Brazil, let me know in the comments, as I am more interested in knowing more voices in the scene to follow and discover new views. So comment there if you know any creator from Latin America that is not from Brazil. Continuing in RPG Latam, this week, Seijin Publishing from Brazil announced an online event for the second semester focusing on OSR and indie tabletop RPGs. And they are interested in international participants as well, in case you are interested in the scene in Latin America. So if you have some disponibility to talk about what are your products, talk about OSR scene, talk about indie scene, DMing some games or anything like that, check it out and perhaps we can have even better links and communication. And one last thing before we pass to the interview with Bianca Momatos is that I unfortunately did not mention her game about capybaras during the interview. And you really deserve to know that it exists. Without further ado, let's go to the interview. So as I mentioned, we will start this interview with Momatos on Twitter. She's called Bianca, and she is the one that came up with the idea and actually did the whole platform for across RPGC. I guess that you are already familiar with across RPGC, but if not, I will let Bianca introduce you to it and explain what she wanted and from where she came with this idea.
All right. So thanks for introducing me. So I'm Veros. My real life name is Bianca. I come from the Philippines, where recently there's been a lot of indie game designers releasing really great games, connecting with others in Southeast Asia as well. And we even had a virtual con on the January 30. So we had a lot of games, but I also noticed that it was a bit hard for people to discover them. We published games on itch.io, which has been fantastic for indie game designers, but their user experience, their UI, there's a lot to be desired. And there's also something really good about seeing all community projects together in one platform. So I thought, why not try doing something like StumbleUpon or a gacha game where you could roll for a random game, it shows up, and if you like it, you go visit their page. If not, you go see what other game designers have to offer. And that's how Across RPGC came about. It's basically a platform for discovering your next favorite Southeast Asian game through a StumbleUpon random rolling experience.
Yeah, I saw that you have already like 40 plus games there, so it's getting steam. And you came, it was you that did all the platform actually. You are like, it's a one person effort.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's amazing because actually I am from Brazil, as some people know. So we are trying to follow up with some of the ideas that RPGC is putting up and with RPG Latam. And the moment I introduced them to Across RPGC, they said, holy, they are always doing amazing in RPGC and with these different approaches to it. So congratulations. But I know as well that you also design games, and during February you had
a kind of all your money that you were getting from a project was going towards a donation. So why don't you talk a little bit about Magus and what was the project for?
So thanks for bringing that up. So the Magus is one of the games that I designed. It's a solo journaling game where you play from the perspective of a wizard who wants power, basically, but it comes at a cost, because the moment you focus on getting spells, that means you have to say no to connecting with others, say no with other self-enriching activities because of your single-minded focus on becoming the greatest mage that ever lived. So that's a journaling game, basically inspired by the 1,000-year-old vampire and other journaling games before it. And I decided that for the first month that I introduced it, 100% of sales would be going towards a mental health charity in the Philippines. So I also thought that there are two reasons for it. First, of course, is the I want to make a good impact on others who need it more than me. And I've seen some mental health organizations do a lot of really good things for frontline workers, for people who don't have money to go to therapy and medical services. So I really wanted to contribute to that cause. The second is, it was launched around Session Zero, that online con in January 30. So it's the best opportunity to get a lot of eyeballs on it. And I really wanted to capture that opportunity and turn it to something that has impact. Just to illustrate my point, the first 3 days after it was launched in Session Zero Con, it got maybe 80% of its current funding. So this is a month-long charity drive, but the first 3 days, 80% of it, that's where most of the attention happened. So I wanted to maximize that opportunity, and I wanted to help out people in need as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great initiative. And I am happy that you are able to gather this attention and to put it to this good cause. And actually, I was just looking at a thread in Twitter right now, just before our interview, that was put by Clayton. He usually reviews layout and the visual aspect. And he was full of praises. He said about the Magus layout with the type fonts choices and so on. And I have to say that I was really impressed with the quality of everything at all. And it brings some vibes from Mark Borg or some other kind of exploratory, at least in my way. You did it in PowerPoint? Is it like... is it true or...?
Yeah, it's true. I remember I just offhandedly mentioned it to some Twitter thread, and then suddenly people were like, what? What did you do? I did it in PowerPoint.
But it looks great. I mean, if you don't mind, why did you choose like PowerPoint? It was familiarity or?
Yeah. I usually actually do layout with a very outdated InDesign. It's like decades old, but it's been really, really useful to me. It's like a loyal companion. But the pandemic hit, people are moving towards digital forms, and PowerPoint suddenly feels a bit intuitive for doing something geared towards digital play. Like InDesign, Affinity Publisher, they're great for print. But suddenly with PowerPoint, you could just easily move things about. It comes in a widescreen format. And maybe in the future, you could add animation to it. But also, it's really great for starting out and doing exploratory design, because one of the strengths of InDesign and Affinity Publisher is that you could have grids, you could have a systematic way of saying these are the header styles, these are the character styles, these are the standards across the entire department. With PowerPoint, you're kind of like you're on your own. Your design on one slide, the next slide could have something completely different from that, which is bad for doing a very organized kind of document, but the Magus is not an organized kind of document. Every page, at least for the first half of it, is its own design. So PowerPoint was actually able to enable that. So I would actually encourage somebody who wants to learn graphic design and layout, you don't have to force yourself to get the expensive layout software first. Try out your layout and graphic design principles, apply it to PowerPoint, apply it even to MS Paint. You could already do a lot with just the most basic and essential tools.
Yeah, I would say that it is already amazing to look at it without knowing that it was made in PowerPoint. But after that, I was like mesmerized because it was really a work of art. And it's very nice that you mentioned that now with so many things going into digital, with the pandemic even more, then using PowerPoint and the way that you set up the pages, they are not like the regular letter format. They are made with the idea of using it in a screen. And so I really thought that it was very interesting. And following from seeing Magus, I went to check each page and I saw that you have a new project that is still in the making, RPG Arc or Arc RPG, I don't know.
Yeah, so RPG is basically like an adventure game. It's a game that focuses on limited time and high stakes adventure because the core concept is there's a literal real life timer counting down. And when that counter hits the end, the apocalypse happens or something else happens, something bad. So everybody is feeling like, oh no, we only have literally 1 hour left. We need to find that tavern to get to that shady guy in the corner to give us the clues. And we need to defeat the big boss by the end of that. So that's the core concept of the game. It's actually been completed, like writing, editing, layout last year. But unfortunately, I needed to be in the hospital for quite a long time. So we postponed the Kickstarter for it. It's happening with Exalted Funeral this year. We're finalizing the details of the launch date. But the demo is there. Anyone can download it from my itch page. And I'm even looking forward to making an SRD so anyone can see the text in the system even before they support a Kickstarter launch.
Oh, that's unfortunate to hear about the hospital thing, but that seems like a very good idea about ARC RPG. And actually, doing it with Exalted Funerals is also, I've heard great praises about them. So it's nice that things are getting now in a way and you are being able to organize it. I still haven't downloaded the quick start of it. I saw that it was available, but I will certainly give it a look. And actually for anyone watching, I will put in the description all the links so that people can follow up. And I believe that so now you are completely focused on this project. So I won't like bother you with asking about further projects. But if you want also, you mentioned more than once the Session Zero con. So how was your experience with that? Because I really enjoyed the idea that you, and the whole environment that Session Zero was putting there. So how do you experience it? Because probably you are like closer to it.
Yeah. So I'm friends with the organizers and I saw that even 4 months before they were working hard, reaching out to designers, making sure that we could get representation from as many countries as they possibly could, setting up the infrastructure around it as well. So they used a pretty innovative platform for it, gather.town. So when you come into the con, you show up as a tiny sprite And then you could control that avatar in the map and then interact with other sprites in the convention itself. So it was really cool on the technical side. On the implementation side, there was a lot of care that went into it. But of course, the thing that a lot of people will look for is what is the impact of the convention? I think the biggest impact is that a lot of people are noticing that we have a lot of exciting things to do and to offer. And you've also mentioned that RPG Lat also started looking at it and seeing that there is so many possibilities that we could do. And it kind of brings me to something that I've been thinking about lately for indie designers, for people coming from marginalized groups or countries. It's really hard to imagine something that's been called like the art of tomorrow, the art of thinking about the future, because we've been so enmeshed in systems and so enmeshed in cultures that say, this is the status quo, this is what you're supposed to be doing. But with things like Session Zero, showing you can have a virtual con and showing you can gather people from across the region and each of them have very unique perspectives, they start showing us that the status quo doesn't have to be the forever state. We can start dreaming about beautiful tomorrows that are more fair, that give us more opportunities. So that links to a lot of aspirations that the organizing team has and has also kind of fueled the across RPG spirit of helping people discover these games so we could start empowering the community and creating a nicer tomorrow for everyone.
Yeah, for sure. I couldn't have said better. And it's very nice that we have this these initiatives from RPGC and from RPG Latam starting a little bit and following the path that was laid out by RPGC and it inspires us to try and sort of quit that idea that the whole RPG scene is Europe or mostly US and a little bit of Europe. So it's nice to see this having an impact, as you mentioned. And I don't know if you felt this impact already or if it is something that you think that will be stronger in the future. How do you feel about it?
Yeah, so I guess I could back up my thoughts with some stats. So I look up the stats for who are actually visiting the site. Most of it, I would say maybe more than 2/5, which is a bit of an awkward fraction, would be from the US. And then the rest would be people from Europe. I looked at my sales and my own personal itch page. It's the same stats, mostly US and then some Europe. Side note, I've been getting a lot of love for some reason from the French RPG community. It shocked me, but it's something I really like. And then I also look at the stats at Session Zero, who visited us. It was the same story. So we are getting a lot of attention from the US, which is fantastic, and from the West as well, because that's pivotal in basically showing that it's not just your scene, it's everybody's scene. But something that I kinda want in the future is seeing more traffic from within our own region. Seeing more people from Malaysia, from Indonesia, Thailand, Philippines, hell, even China or Japan come in and see that, hey, we have a lot of game designers from our own home. This is pretty cool. I wonder what kind of factors would be the reason for that. It could just be that relative to the US, tabletop game design isn't such an established hobby. But sometimes I do worry that the indie game design here in our region is focused on the current game design community. Like, we play each other's games, we support each other, but the pool is getting deeper with rich opportunities, but I want to see it wider and start reaching out my fellow Filipinos, for example, who wouldn't even think of touching a polyhedral dice. So that kind of went way beyond your questions. I'm super sorry about that.
No, no problem at all.
But yeah, that's the kind of impact I'm seeing. We're getting a lot more attention from the traditional markets, but there's still so much left to go for if we want to make the ocean serve all islands, or whatever metaphor works in this scenario.
Totally, and it's something that I guess it is important to be able, it's nice to have this impact and to have this attention from outside, from the big markets, because it empowers us and it shows it that what we are doing in these new initiatives, it has value. But I agree that it's also something very important to popularize inside our region or inside our communities, so that game design and playing game, perhaps you do not want to design games, but you want to play games and to see it as a valid hobby and to see and support it from the people close to you as well. I guess that it's something that is really important. I was also so, and there is no problem with deviating a little bit, because it's an interview, and so we are interested in hearing from you and what you have to say. And so it's also very interesting to see this kind of statistics about the countries. And so you mentioned about France, and I saw that you even posted, like, someone did the journaling in French and mentioned it. So how did it got to your attention?
I was involved in a Kickstarter by a French designer, and I suspect he posted about some of my games to their Discord, and then suddenly I see it on Twitter, someone making a playthrough of my game in a language I didn't speak, which was kind of a crazy concept to me. When you start designing games, you think that, oh, my friends will play it, my family will support it. But it's like a crazy dream to think about somebody from the opposite side of the world would notice it and say, hey, this is pretty cool. And, you know, that feels really, really good.
Yeah, I imagine that it feels empowering, like to see. It's bad to for us to base our value in outside praise, but it's always nice when you see your hard work paying off and being appreciated as well. Because I believe, at least when I design games, I design games a little bit for myself, but I also design games so that I can see other people enjoying or getting this value from what I am trying to offer. So I imagine that it's something, a common feeling between game designers.
Yeah. It's also kind of a tricky thing, because a lot of game design depends on people playing it with friends. So you're not just convincing one person to buy your game, you're convincing that person to try my game and then do the hard work of finding others to play it with you, right? So it's really difficult. It's a challenge for sure.
Yeah, but I recently, like recently now with the pandemic, we lose a lot of the idea of time. But the beginning of the pandemic, I discovered journaling games, and it was something that I had never explored before. And I believe that it's a very nice thing that is coming from the indie scene, to have these kind of different experiences with games, and that you don't have to always have that four friends and the GM, and this will be the game for every game, doesn't matter whatever you want to do it. So I guess that the idea of Magus, with being a journaling solo game, it's also something that that you can play with this idea of this kind of creativity with yourself.
Yeah, it's when I was doing a lot of the database cleanup and then adding more games and across RPGC, I would sometimes come across games that aren't campaign based. So we have the solo games, but we also have games that were like two players. So it's a lot of interesting new modalities. We have this set notion that games by default should be like D&D. So as you mentioned, four players, one GM, every session, 1 year, or if you're lucky. But as more and more indie designers get into the scene, these are people who are open to being creative about how game interactions are made. Part of that is because we have also really nothing to lose. I mean, imagine if, WotC came out with a solo journaling game, people would still buy it. That's their power. But imagine if WotC said D&D is now going to be a lyric game. With indie designers, of course, we don't have that kind of qualms. And we also come from a really rich background of perspectives. And sometimes game design can be an expression of that perspective. So I've seen games about migrants, games about the difficulty of war, and we start bringing this out into RPGs and discovering what's the best way to express this. Maybe a solo RPG, maybe an RPG where you need to text others to find a missing person, maybe something you can play on Discord. So it's really cool and interesting. There's such a wealth of expression, but that also comes with its own challenges, because you can't really put a language or taxonomy around that. I mean, there's a game out there where your roommate's with Adam Driver and he's showing you his screenplay and it's a super weird game, but somebody from, say, Belgium, how is he going to hear about that game? How is he going to care about that game? So we have so many indie products, but how do you share that information and awareness? So it's a really interesting, I'm not sure if interesting is the right word, but it's a really big ecosystem, and that comes with its pitfalls and benefits as well.
Yeah, this is one thing that made me fall in love with the idea of the indie scene, because you have a lot of things that really follow the standard way. Like you have a lot of old school based systems and so on, but you also have this exploratory, this kind of games, or even sometimes they are not even games, they are just a zine with some ideas to implement in other games that just throw all the structure out of the window and bring something completely different. And I guess it also empowers people to see that RPG doesn't need to be that for people with the GM, and then they maybe find something that will bring them into playing a tabletop game. So it's true that probably we are also now going into the difficult part of making people aware of all of this. So <Yep. laughs> as you mentioned, it is something that it's complicated, but I guess this is something very nice of across RPGC, because you do not go there and take a drop down of categories and select one. You just explore. You try to see what's next. You read about it. Perhaps you like it. Perhaps it's interesting to you or not. And then you try another one. And it was, for me, it was really nice, the idea of this random table of games.
Yeah. That's a really good way of putting it. D66 random RPGC games. You put it in your next D&D adventure.
Yeah. I mean, God knows that we love doing random tables in the indie scene. So it really fits with the motive. So, I mean, the chat is very good, but we are close to the 30-minute mark. And so do you have anything additionally that you want to speak about? Or
Yeah. I guess for indie game designers, I'm trying to come up with my thoughts. Sorry, I'm still stuck on Adam Driver giving you a messed up script. But for indie game designers, you have much more freedom now to publish what you want. You don't need to use InDesign or Affinity Publisher. You can use PowerPoint. There are so many resources available. You should try connecting with your community as well. See people in your area doing the same thing, or even people from across the world. So there is more connections and more inroads now towards game design. And for everybody else looking into this indie game design scene, there is just one big request I'd like to make. Please, when you download a game, leave a review. If it's positive, if it's glowing, that's fantastic. If it's less than ideal, please say why it wasn't right for you, so game designers know that people are paying attention, playing that game, and know how to improve and make a game. Well, no, not even improve, know how they can reach out to your kind of preference better. So leave a review, leave a like, share the word, and help indie game designers have more fun and have more impact in the world out there.
Yeah, a glowing review can make your week, and rating a game is free. So just go. So thank you very much for your time. Actually, I wholly support the message of rating and reviewing games. It's a thing. And we will catch up later. And I will put the link to Across RPGC and the other project that we talked in the description. And thank you very much for that. So have a nice time.
You do. Thanks so much.
And if you like a video, like the video, share, subscribe. You know how internet works. If you want, you can pay me a coffee on Ko-fi, or you can check my games in itch.io. Links in the description, as always. And I will see you all in my next video. So, see ya!